I'm going to show you a game which is truly a battle of the generations. 50-year-old Vasily Ivanchuk against 14-year-old Ramesh Babu Pragyanananda. Well, this is quite extraordinary. A 36-year age gap between the two. This is played in the sixth round of the Sunway Citrus Open here in Spain, where I'm commentating. Do check out our live commentary. Game start at 4:30. And both players on 4 out of 5. Ivanchuk started slowly in the tournament, and Pragyananda lost in the previous round against Korobov. So let's see how they fared. Ivanchuk with the white pieces, and it's gone into an open Sicilian and the Sozin variation. Now, if black plays the normal move e6, then it could be that white will play bishop e3 and the queen goes to e2 and white will castle on the queen side, the so-called Vlimirovich attack. So instead of e6, Pragyananda plays queen b6, and this is a way of avoiding those lines where white castles queenside, or in most cases anyway. So the idea is that bishop e3 isn't possible because the queen can actually just take on b2. So white plays knight b5. This is the standard move. And after a6, only then plays bishop e3 to drive the queen out of the way. Knight d4. So after that little shuffle, both sides have kind of lost tempi, but we're approaching more of a normal position. By the way, knight takes e4, not a good move here because of queen f3 attacking here and looking through to that knight on c6 as well. So that's not on. However, there are a couple of, a few decent moves here. Pragyananda played e6, which is fine. You can also play knight g4 here. I've played knight e5 myself. That's reasonable. And in fact, Ivanchuk has had this previously with white against Kramnik, and the game went like this, quite a sharp line. And then f4. So black loses a lot of time with the queen and the knight, but does bag the two bishops. So yeah, it's a really complicated line that, and he managed to beat Kramnik. But knight g4 and knight e5 are quite possible, but e6 more orthodox from Pragyananda. And now we reach a kind of Sozin variation. And here, well, Kramnik, he was a great expert in this four knights classical Sicilian. And he showed the way to go against Short, Novgorod, 1996. He simply castled here and played with bishop d7. And in fact, the queen is not badly placed here. And after this, well, let me show you just very quickly what happened. Which is quite instructive. This, of course, was the way that Fischer liked to play, advancing this f-pawn. But Kramnik simply took this and played bishop c6 to the long diagonal, and then rook ae8. And he dropped his knight back here, put the bishop on f6. Gave up the d-pawn, but actually in this position black's pieces are so active, and that bishop on c6 is absolutely beautiful, striking down across the board, and he's ready to play rook e5, and black has excellent compensation for the pawn actually. So that's one way of playing, but for me that's kind of typical Kramnik actually. He somehow managed to coordinate all his pieces so beautifully. But instead, Pragyananda exchanged on d4. Now, I don't think that's a bad move. I think that's okay. Again, we reach a kind of Sozin in the position. The only thing is that after b5, you can see that the queen is somewhat shut out of play. the way Kramnik played it was far more harmonious. The queen was actually stood in a nice position. But here it's clear that Black's queen is going to have to move again. But the bishop is on the long diagonal, so that's not bad. And king h1. So white will have to decide at some moment whether he plays e5 or f5, or just leaves things standing. And here, yeah, the queen should move. Here Prague played the queen back to d8, which looks very odd to me. I don't quite understand why it went all the way back. It seems to me that the queen c7 is absolutely normal here. And yeah, it's pretty balanced. I slightly prefer white, but it's not a bad position for black. But queen d8 seems to me hands the initiative to white, because the black basically hasn't completed his development. And here, f5 looks like a very tempting move. I mean, maybe this is what Prague had in mind, because in this case, you can make a classic Sicilian exchange sack and take that pawn on e4. And that could be very good fun for black, because in fact, this bishop is so much stronger than, say, the one on b3 or indeed the one on g1. So rook e1 is, of course, very sensible from Ivanchuk, supporting the e-pawn. Then rook e8. Okay, the bishop might drop back to f8, we'll see. And here, again, lots of the tempting moves. At first, I thought e5 should be very strong here. But in fact, after this, the knight goes back to d7. And if the knight swings to e4, now if it can land on d6 or maybe even f6, that's very strong, but black exchanges this off. And actually in this position, everything has worked out fine for black. That bishop is the problem here. It's really doing nothing in this position, hitting e6. Well, other possibilities. I thought maybe rook e3 here, with potentially the option to swing to g3 or h3. Or there's f5, also interesting. But once again, an exchange sacrifice is possible. Now in this position, at the moment, black isn't taking on e4, but there's queen a8. Absolutely typical for these kind of Nydorf-Sozin positions. Ditch the exchange, and then the queen has a great square on a8, cutting down the diagonal. e4 is going to drop, and g2 is under pressure as well. So, what did Ivanchuk do? He was very careful at this moment. Pragyananda was investing a lot of time. Ivanchuk thought for about 10 minutes over this move. Rook e2, very calm move indeed, making sure that this and this are protected, and just kind of, it's almost like a waiting move actually, seeing how black commits. Bishop f8, and now f5 is certainly possible. Well, if black sacrifices the exchange, then it will be possible, for example, for white to hold the e-pawn. So that's one point, well, by doubling rooks behind the e-pawn. So that's one point behind rook e2. But this is reasonable for white, because that bishop can bounce out here, try to knock out the knight on f6, and occupy d5. I think it's just strategically very unclear. There are ways for black to counter that. But again, Ivanchuk didn't commit himself. He just played queen h3, so that queen is lurking. Now, black has a big range of possibilities. It is possible to sack the exchange here, but actually this one isn't quite as clear when this pawn stands on f4. Black has some compensation, of course. But the move after queen h3 that I really like, and is so typical of these positions in many different variations, is a5. So obviously black wants to push forward with b4, drive the knight out of the way and get through to e4. And if knight takes b5, then knight takes e4. That's usually desirable for black to knock out this centre pawn. And there's also bishop takes knight. So now e4 can't be taken, but black will plunge in with queen b2 and then f5. So black is under pressure here on the light squares, but it's highly unclear because black's queen has broken through to a nice position and has split these pawns. But in this case, at least, you know, white's bishop is very active here. It looks like it's going to play a full role in the game. Anyway, very unclear, but a5 looks like the typical move for these positions. Instead, Prague played a move which found very surprising, d5. And e5 from Ivanchuk. And now things are really nice for white, because now we have this typical French pawn structure. Except here, this is a highly favourable version for white, because there's a beautiful blockader on d4. And white's pieces are already massed to attack on the king side. So knight e4 at least puts the knight to a nice position. But now, of course, f5, and white is breaking through. Now, white still has to deal with that knight. However, if white can exchange, and, well, you can see we're breaking through here. So it's probably best for black to exchange that off and then take on f5. White is definitely better here because that bishop is going to come back to blockade on d4, and there's some pressure here. And who knows, after bishop d4, c3, maybe the bishop can come back to c2. This bishop, you'll see, when white blockades on d4, it's doing nothing at all. This is black's problem. So let's go back. So black should have exchanged here and taken on f5. But instead, Prague really misjudged the situation. He was running short of time, and very quickly he played knight c5. He looked already quite demoralized here. Well, certainly after f6, he had reason to feel pretty upset, because now it's absolutely horrible. Black has no decent counterplay, and white is just going straight ahead on the king side. I mean, really, the black's best is to play g6, closing things. But after rook f4, white's attack is so simple. Just switching across the h-file, and if necessary, you sacrifice to break open. And there is no decent counterplay for black. It's just lost now. Prague took the bishop. Still not possible to upset the blockader with rook c4 because the pawn covers a5, but this is just too slow. And hit, for example, g6, rook f4. You can just give up the knight and you're breaking through on the king side. Well, there's not even time to take it. This is checkmate very quickly. So rook e3 just played, b4. Now, let's break open the king side. Rook g3 threatens to play queen h6. Therefore, rook e7, allowing the queen to defend here. Now, rook f4. The knight drops, but now it's forced checkmate. Queen h6. Queen f8 defends. Rook h4, threatening mate on h7. F5, and now it is forced checkmate. Really simple. Check. The king has to go back to g8. Now rook h3 and mate on h8. Game over. What an absolute crush. But really, Prague had such a bad day, and he looks really demoralized after two losses in a row against the two top Ukrainian players. It's funny, Korobov was with us in the studio looking through his game, and he said that he was watching Prague and he had the feeling that Prague just didn't want to be there today. Well, that's something that he's going to have to tackle if he wants to make progress. Of course, he's doing really well at the moment, but really, two losses in a row. It's not that. It's that in this second game, he didn't put up a big fight. D5 was really not a very attractive move from Black at all. So there we go. Ivanchuk rising to the top of the tournament. But at the moment, Korobov leads with 6 out of 6. Thanks for watching.